Hello and welcome to the Universal Blueprint channel, where we are looking at the use of spiritual devices, items, implements, and generally things that can be used to help focus or kind of bring mental stability to spiritual practices after enlightenment has been achieved. Now, we're going to stick with our Arabian theme. We looked at flying carpets in our last video, which is quite a fun thing for me to do. Now, this we're going to stick on this and look at genies in bottles. Or genies in lamps, or magic lamps. Now, this we all know from the idea of things, for example, of Aladdin or Arabian Nights, those kind of things. And these are real things that are used within spirituality and development at those times in those locations. Remember that people practicing spiritual practices in at those times have to use what's available in their culture at their given time period. And so that is what they used at that time. Now, what they believed was that obviously you had genies in magic lamps, or that genies were put in magic lamps. So let's just unpack that for a little bit. So the idea of what is a genie? Well, a genie is a form of a spirit or a demon or an angel or those kind of things. And we're going to look at what those are in more detail in different videos when we come to the angelic systems. But essentially, let's just go with, so these beings are metamorphosized or kind of personified forces of the universe, such as if we're looking at modern day concepts, it's like programs made into beings that we can then relate to. So it's things that exist in the universe, powers and forces, such as the power of gravity or the power of electricity or the power of, and you can scale it up or down according to however you want to look at it, you know. The power of a spirit of all electricity in the world, or all of man-made used electricity, or the electricity just in this plug. You know, you can scale it up or down, and each one has a different kind of spirit or level which answers to one another, which is like the angelic hierarchy, for example. And you can use these in more personal terms, such as emotional spirits. So my anger, or the anger of my family, or the anger of my community, or the anger of the world, or the anger of the universe. And each one has a like a ruling power within, and the more precise you go, the less lower we are in the hierarchy, but more relatable. And what we do is, as human beings, is we personify them as human beings in order to understand them or relate to them, to be able to communicate with them. They're not actually human beings, and this is what angels are, essentially, and demons. They are forces of nature and the universe that are not people, but we see them as a humanoid thing to in our minds in order to try and relate to them. Like God. God is not a person. It's not a man on a cloud. That context came much later on by accident, through misconceptions and so on, through times during kind of a medieval Christian priesthood era. And there's reasons for that, and we'll go into that in another time. But essentially, we personify God as man, because why would he not be a human figure when we are human and we're trying to relate it to ourselves, and therefore he must also be a physical body that looks like a human. And you might just, that's the rock at that factor, because that's just such a naive and egotistical way of looking at the universe. But at the same time, if we described man or met God, then we would likely try and view him as a humanoid figure. And same with angels and so on and so on and so on. And genies are no different. It's the same thing, just different name. That's all it is. It's exactly the same name. And so it's funny, because people believe in genies but don't believe in angels, or people believe in angels and call genies complete nonsense. But it's the same thing, but describing the same context. It's just that it's just describing a different language at a different time in a different culture. That's all, nice and simple. We need to realize that when we look at these things, or we just get lost. Now, the idea of a genie is that you rub the lamp, they come out the lamp, and or you release them, and then they give you three wishes, is the connotation. But interestingly enough, the three wishes relates to in the mind space, the mind palace, when you summon one of these forces or spirits and trying to communicate with it, understand it, or observe it outside of the sacred circle, which could be a flying carpet, as we mentioned in the last video. It could just be a circle in the sand, and you try and have a conversation with it, and obviously, you know, it all comes comes down to, is it your imagination or is it you trying to just work on a higher level of reality and trying to meet in the middle and so on? We can go down that rabbit hole and we will do in different series. But this is what it's for, and this is what you use for, and this is how you would apply it. So you summon these spirits down into your mind palace and you will talk to them in their perceived human or half-human or humanoid form, which is things like, again, what can be described as Medusa or the gods and all beasts and animals and all these other things, spirits, but you would have. And you would, the standard rule that's always been through time, even from the shamanic period all the way till to modern day, is that you always ask everything three times. Because they can't, the right answer will be given on the third time. So it's like, are you really the spirit of fire, for example? And you would say, and they would give you an answer, and you say, are you a spirit of fire? And you would do that three times, and they have to give you the answer on the third time. Because it's like a mental concentration aspect. If you have the discipline to command an answer three times, then you will get the correct answer. It's nothing to do with them being, because remember, they're a personified version of a force that is not a human and therefore doesn't have a mind like we do. It's not the same thing. It's more your mind interpreting their answer in the correct way, and therefore you ask them three times for clarity, once on a physical level, an energetic level, and a mental level, and the third time, the third echo is the one that you will get and is correct. And that's what the three wishes are. I wish for you to tell me this, I wish for you to tell me this, I wish for you to tell me this, and that then you will get your correct answer, or your heart's desire, as so the story goes. And that's what it is, and that's why we open these lamps. Now, what's interestingly enough is that the lamp is obviously an oil burning lamp in that kind of culture or area, and it's all to do with the light as well, because obviously it's an oil burning lamp, which is a light, but it's also a perfect container. So what they said is, what, but when you're doing your rituals and connotations and things like that, and you're bringing spirits into that space, you have the oil lamp burning at that time so that the flame attracts the spirits and the energy. And that's what it is. That's why you use candles. We'll look at candles in another video within this series quite soon. But that is like a moth to a flame, and it draws people in. So that's how we can supposedly capture them and bring them in. But what it is, it's your mind and your focus putting them into that container. It'll be a sealed container. It's almost like Schrodinger's theory of putting something in a box and sealing it. You don't really know it's there until you open it. Now, there is another version of the genie in the bottle, which is in the West and side of culture, and we know it very, very well. There's two. There's one in Greek and there's one in Judaism. The Greek one is Pandora's box. So it's not a new concept. But remember, this was made after Pandora's box. So they would have got the idea from there, because it's something that's been taught all the way through history and time. And I've done this ritual many times, in fact, many, many, many times. And so I can vouch for the use and the proof and the pudding, so to speak. And the Pandora's box is essentially somebody opening somebody else's, or gods, we would at very many microcosmic levels, but somebody or the woman opening Pandora's box, which is God's genie in a bottle, effectively, because she opens it and all the bad things come out and all the good things are in at the end, and then she lets it out. But it's like all the spirits are trapped in there. And sealed in there because they are meant to be bound until they're released into the world and create chaos. And that is the world, that is an analogy of the world's evils that are contained within all people. But equally, we can all do this. We can all put our own negative aspects into containers and we can lock them away and bury them. And it's like, it's in the mind space, remember. It's not, you're not literally ripping out your own negativity, putting it into a jar or a bottle or an oil lamp and then burying it or burning it or whatever. Because that doesn't make any sense. What it is you're mentally putting them in there so that in your mind, your psychological context knows that you have shut it away, you have removed it from yourself, and I don't have to worry about that anymore. Has anyone ever seen Inception? This is an important film. We could go into a rabbit hole with this, but basically he keeps his most guarded negative secret about he thinks he killed his wife, and he puts it in that lower locked room level where nobody can get to, and he keeps it down. Same thing, you're locking it away in a material object such as a bottle or like a lamp, and then you're burying it, and then in your mind you are relieved of it, you are released of that burden, and therefore free to continue your life as is. And that's what it is. It's symbolic, but mentally it's a mental practice, it's a psychological practice to do. And you might say, oh, you're just lying to yourself, it's bloody bollocks, it's still in you. But actually you are doing it, and if it makes you better as a person, if you are mentally unbaggaging yourself, unburdening yourself and putting it away and forgetting, I don't have to think about that because I've locked it away, it's gone forever, it's there, then, and you become a better person, that is part of spiritual development, part of enlightenment, and that's what it's all about. So isn't that not just a physical act of doing one of these things to help yourself elevate into the world? And so it's a practice I encourage people to do quite often, in fact. And what's important here is that you can release that, because you can leave it. It was, remember, the lamp, the genie in the lamp was in a hidden cave, sealed away from the world, from all people to see. It was never meant to be opened, and now it has, and the person has felt that energy, and it's concentrated and festered and explored, and it's come out. And that's what it is. And you can do this in the mind palace. You don't need a physical real bottle. You can put it in a bottle in the mind space, in the mind palace, in the mind, and bury it in the mind as well. And so you can just keep doing this and do it wherever. Like if a bad thought enters your mind, if you've got anxiety, is the door locked? You could be like, right, I've checked it's locked. Right, I don't need that thought anymore. I'm going to put it into this bottle in my mind, and then I'm going to bury it in this piece of land. And now I know that thought is in that bottle, in that place. It's not going anywhere. It's done. I can forget about it. I can walk away from the door because I know it's locked, because I've put that thought in it. I don't have to think about it anymore. And it's a good training tool, it's a good mental exercise to do. Obviously, if you want to go a step further, you can do it physically. And therefore, you actually know in this physical world, I know in certain places, certain parts of the world, all over the country, in fact, the world, that these negative things that I've been, you know, holding on to or wish to keep away on any level, it could be small things, big things, it could be evil as a whole, it's buried in certain places. I know that I could go back and dig it up and let it out if I wanted to, but I won't, so I don't need to, so it's done. And that's what it is. And we've got another example in Judaism. We mentioned Israel, of King Solomon. Now King Solomon is known to have done this. He summoned the seven demons of the world, and he put them in a box and he buried them. And it was only until after, when somebody dug it up and opened it, all the demons came out and flooded the kingdom. Same thing as Pandora's box. Exactly the same practice as the genie in the bottle. Now the thing is, here, is he was doing it on behalf of his kingdom, his people. So he was trying to lock away the demons and the evil of his people and store them. So it's a symbolic act of him trying to implement justice within the society. Tell them, you know, we need to be good people, it's meant to be positive community, we're meant to help each other, so we're going to lock away the demons. I'm going to lock away the demons by creating laws of justice and rulership and order. But also physically he may have also done this, because it's like a symbolic thing of, in his mind, I am going to try and lock away the demons of our culture. Now I put them in this box and lock them away, bury them, and now I will go away. And knowing that I buried them, I can work on doing the things that these elements have done, and therefore direct his focus into helping his people recover from these atrocities that were done in previous times before his rulership. Until someone opens it and it's like, right, well, somebody else has started to do these things, because he must have opened the box to find it to then start putting all this anger, which is, it's a symbolic story of someone breaking the rules effectively and bringing bad things into the city or group of people. And that's what the story is. It's interesting. I'm sure there will be an example within Egyptian culture, perhaps using the canopic jars, but I haven't found one as yet that I can remember off the top of my head. But I'm sure there will be one, because it's a practice they will have used also, which is part of probably, like I say, using canopic jars as an instrument. So that's what it is. That's our story, and that's what a genie in the bottle really is. And we've seen very many versions of it already, and these hundreds of thousands of examples of these things being done all over the world, different cultures in India, and obviously in Taoism as well. So I hope you enjoyed it. It's quite an interesting one. It's one of my favourites. So yeah, I hope you appreciate it. I hope you can use it to either understand people who do this sort of thing, or also incorporate it into your own system of study yourself. As I say, it's something I do regularly, and have appreciated the fruits of the labour, as it were. So yeah, that's it for now. Please like, subscribe, share. It really does help the channel. If you get the notification bell, you can find out when our next video is out. If you want more information about spiritual development as a whole and our teachings and guide into developing oneself to match the cycles and solar system cycles and patterns of the universe, then please pick up a copy of our book either from the website or Amazon. The link is in the description below. It's 10 books in the series, each one quite important in their own right, and they're available in ebook, softbook, and hardback. And that's it for now. Thank you very much and take care. Goodbye. Hello and welcome to the Universal Blueprint channel, where we are looking at the use of spiritual devices, items, implements, and generally things that can be used to help focus or kind of bring mental stability to spiritual practices after enlightenment has been achieved. Now, we're going to stick with our Arabian theme. We looked at flying carpets in our last video, which is quite a fun thing for me to do. Now, this we're going to stick on this and look at genies in bottles. Or genies in lamps, or magic lamps. Now, this we all know from the idea of things, for example, of Aladdin or Arabian Nights, those kind of things. And these are real things that are used within spirituality and development at those times in those locations. Remember that people practicing spiritual practices in at those times have to use what's available in their culture at their given time period. And so that is what they used at that time. Now, what they believed was that obviously you had genies in magic lamps, or that genies were put in magic lamps. So let's just unpack that for a little bit. So the idea of what is a genie? Well, a genie is a form of a spirit or a demon or an angel, all those kind of things. And we're going to look at what those are in more detail in different videos when we come to the angelic systems. But essentially, let's just go with, so these beings are metamorphosized or kind of personified forces of the universe, such as if we're looking at modern day concepts, it's like programs made into beings that we can then relate to. So it's things that exist in the universe, powers and forces such as